हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट पेटी शीट नंबर 3, दैट इज टाइप्स ऑफ बोल्ट्स। टाइप्स ऑफ बोल्ट्स, सो वी ऑलरेडी हैव एक्सरसाइज बुक इन फ्रंट ऑफ अस। देर आर सेवरल बोल्ट्स दैट आर शोन, लेट अस स्टडी देम वन बाय वन, starting with the hexagonal headed bolt. Now this is very common bolt, the head shape is hexagon, then this is the stem of the bolt, that is you can say the body of the bolt, and on this body, say the body is of length capital L, the size of the bolt is shown by capital D. Out of this length L, the length X is given threading. So threading in this case is not for the entire length L, it is only for length X. Then this part is a hexagonal head. So as you can see the end view, it is showing the hexagonal shape. Then there is a circle. Now last time we explained the meaning of this circle. This is called the chamfer circle. So this chamfer circle is shown here. Then as we have seen last time, this much part, all these parts, whatever triangular shape is shown here, that is a inclined shape. So this is because of the taper shape that is coming after the chamfering action. Then you will see here the convention for threading. So since this is external threading, the outside diameter is seen, the inside diameter is in the groove, so it is not seen. So you can see here outside diameter is complete circle and the inside diameter is incomplete circle, and it is like comparatively it is medium, outside circle is dark. Now since you are seeing in this direction, threading is not seen, therefore it is dotted. Then some other proportions are there. You can see the across corner distance from this corner to this corner, that is called as across corner distance. That is double the size of the bolt. So when you say there is a bolt of size M10, that means D is equal to 10. And accordingly, this becomes 2 times 10, that is 20. This is the thickness of the head, which is 0.8 times the diameter, which will be 8 mm for a 10 mm bolt. So this is hexagonal headed bolt that is shown over here. You can also see another size, that is the size across flat. These are the two flats, in fact there are 6 flats. The size which is measured across the flat, it comes out to be 1.5 D plus 3. So all the dimensions are mentioned in terms of capital D, which is called as the size of the bolt. Then we see here hexagonal headed bolt with a hexagonal nut as well as washer. So now you will find that on this part, at this place, a nut is placed, a nut is positioned here. So you can see here, this part is a nut, then this is a washer, and this nut is going inside to some extent. See, in this example, the threaded length is capital X is 40, total length L is 100. So out of 40 length, the 3 mm length is covered by nut, by the washer, 24 mm is the thickness of the nut, and then part of the bolt threading is seen here and here. You will see that this threading is shown a taper line here at the end. You can see this same threading is shown, how it is shown. The outside size is shown by dark line. The inside line, that is the groove line, which is shown by incomplete circle here, is shown by a medium line, and this medium line becomes taper after this. What is the meaning of this line at a distance of X? This shows that the threading is available till the distance X. After this distance X, threading is still there, but it is a taper threading, it is not functional, it is of no use. So that is shown by this taper sign. So this line goes up to here as a straight line, and after that it becomes a taper line. So here also taper line. So all these conventions are extremely important. We have to draw the threading as per this convention. You can see the washer of diameter 52, which is shown here as a background behind the nut. So we can see here hexagonal headed bolt with hexagonal nut. Now this is a typical nut bolt. Now after this we are going to see different types of nuts. So now you can see here square headed bolt. We are seeing different types of bolts, rather not nuts. Square headed bolt with a square neck. So here the shape of the head of the bolt is like a square, and the stem of the bolt is, of course, as usual it is circular. But then when it is circular, there should be sometimes some provision for locking. So you can see here this much part is given a square shape so that it can remain in some kind of a square hole so that it will not rotate. Some cases it is required. So square headed bolt with a square neck. You can see next is the square headed bolt again without a neck. So this is a typical square headed bolt without a neck. Here it is with neck. Then comes the cylindrical headed bolt over here. This is a cylindrical or cheese headed bolt. Again here the rotation is prevented by providing a small pin over here. This pin can be perpendicular to the axis or it can be parallel to the axis. If it is perpendicular in the end view it looks like this. If it is parallel in the end view it looks like this. The objective is to prevent the rotation of the stem of the nut. So this is a cylindrical or cheese headed bolt. So this is a cheese headed bolt. This is a cylindrical bolt. The other name is cheese headed bolt. Next page we will see some more types of bolts. So you can see here cup headed bolt. Cup headed bolt. The shape of the head is, you can say it is something similar to a half sphere. But it is not exactly half. You can see here it is 0.8 times D. That is a curvature. And then what you see here, this curvature is 0.1 D inside. So this part is only 0.7 mm D, 0.7 times D. Then there is a pin here again, something, some projection is there for preventing the rotation. Or it could be a square shape just like last time. So this is called a cup head. Earlier was a cylindrical head. Now the next is T-headed bolt. T-headed bolt. Now you can see here the shape of the head is like a T. And obviously once it is a T shape, this part again is a square shape. So this prevents the rotation. These are the different views. Now one application, you must have seen this bolt somewhere. In case of drill machine, the base of the drill machine, the platform where you are fitting the job, there you will find sometimes that this kind of a T-headed bolt is used, where this bolt remains in a slot. So if I draw the bolt like this, then there is a, in the machine there is a slot like this. Okay, so what I have drawn is, this is the bed of the machine. So in the bed of the machine there is a slot, and in this T slot, in the groove, this T head of the bolt is going, so that you can use this part of the bolt for the purpose of anything that is to be fixed. So here there is a threading. And this stem of the bolt with the threading has come out, and the part which is to be fixed, that part will come here. If I want to draw, you can see how the part comes. So let us draw the part also. So the part to be fixed, suppose this is a part to be fixed. This is a part you want to fix. So it is placed like this. And after that, at this place, you will see that the nut will be positioned. So nut will come somewhere here like this, because this will not come. So this way you are going to lock. Now this will come just like this. This threading of the bolt is not to be shown. So you can now see that the part, this is a part which is fitted with the help of a T bolt, and then there is a nut from the other side. This way it is used. Next type of bolt you will see here, that is a countersunk headed bolt. This is a countersunk headed bolt. Now what you see here is the head again is different. The head is like a conical shape, and it has got some kind of a projection here like a pin, again for preventing the rotation. The other option is providing a square shape here, which will also be useful for preventing the rotation. The proportions are shown as usual in terms of capital D, where D is the size of the bolt. Now what is to be noted here is, see this is the shape of the bolt. What is to be noted here is the function of such kind of bolt. Now this function, this bolt is used in case where you don't want the head of the bolt to be projected above the surface. So suppose I draw the figure like this. Suppose this is some part, say like a table surface, and you want to fit a bolt here. So suppose you fit a normal bolt, then what will happen is, see, this is a bolt which is fitted on a table, on a table surface. This is a table. So you will find the bolt head is coming above the table surface. Sometimes this will obstruct the function of the table. So what we expect is that the head of the bolt should remain under the flush with the shape of the table. So now I am drawing the countersunk bolt in position. When it is put like this, this is how it will be seen. And now this is the table. To the table there is a threading, and in the threading the bolt has gone, and this part of the hole is not having threading, it is given a countersunk shape. Then the threading starts from here, so that when the bolt is going down, at that time this head of the bolt will be sitting into this cup shape, and as a result the entire head is flush with the top surface of the table, so that this will not be projecting out. In this case the bolt is projecting out, the head of the bolt is projecting out. Here the head of the bolt is remaining inside, so it is called a countersunk kind of a bolt. Then the next bolt is hook bolt. As you see here, this is a hook bolt. It looks like this, the isometric drawing, three dimensional drawing, and then the orthographic drawing, front view, side view. So the shape of the bolt is like this. You can see this surface over here. Out of that is a square shape to prevent the rotation, and is a extension in the form of a hook. Now what does this kind of a bolt do? Now, you know, sometimes what happens, the part to be fitted, you are not expected to make any hole. Say for example, in this case, this was a part to be fitted. So what we have done is we have made one hole over here, and through this hole the bolt is passed. But sometimes it is not possible to provide such hole. Say for example, if this part is like a glass. Now making a hole in the glass is not so easy. So how to hold a glass with the help of a bolt? So that in that case, this kind of a hook bolt can be made use of. So I'll just show here. Let's say this is a glass which you want to clamp, and you are going to clamp this on a surface which is this surface. On this surface you have to clamp. So what is done is, here this is the bolt. Say let's say this is a plate to which you have to clamp. So the bolt is placed like this. Then it has got a threading here which is projecting out, and then see, this is the frame to which you are trying to put this, fit this glass. I'll say this is a glass. And then as usual, we take one nut and try to fit it here. In fact, it can be done the other way. The clamping is on this side. I'll draw it again. It will come something like this with the head coming above like this. And then the nut will come here. Now you are holding the glass. This is a glass. You are holding the glass with the help of a hook bolt like this, without damaging or without making any hole into the glass. So that was the hook bolt. Next we will see what is called as a eye bolt. So as you see here, this bolt is called as eye bolt. The head shape is given something like a eye shape, and the dimensions, the proportions are shown in terms of D as usual. There is a threading at this place. There could be square shape if required, but what is to be observed here is this part of the bolt head, which is like a eye. The use of this part is for the purpose of lifting the machine to which this is fitted. So suppose I'll just draw here. Suppose there is a machine, and this machine you want to lift. So for lifting you need some kind of a hook. So in such case, this bolt is fitted over here. Maybe one more bolt like this. So these two bolts which are fitted here, they are not for clamping anything. They are just for taking the position here, and then with the help of some kind of a hook, you will be able to attach that hook here, and then you will be able to lift. So for the purpose of lifting, you can make use of these bolts, which are called as eye bolts. Now there are some more types there. The same eye bolt is shown here again. Now this eye bolt is fitted like this, and then you can see two views, and then with the help of, suppose there is a hook like this, so this hook will come from here and you will be able to lift it. Next is a tap bolt or cap screw. Now these are, although the drawing is very large, when you say screw means normally it is a bolt but of a smaller size. So here it is shown how these two parts are clamped together, A and B. These are the two parts that are clamped with the help of a bolt, and in this case the internal threading is cut into part B, and then in the part A there is a clear hole. So you can see the size of the bolt is D, whereas the size of the hole is D1, which is larger than D, so that this part of the stem of the bolt will not touch anywhere, and then below there is a threading. This threading will engage into the internal threading provided in part B, so that when you clamp this particular screw, the clamping will take place. This part A will be fitted between this part B and the head of the bolt. So like that the clamping will take place. This is a general clamping which is applicable for a screw or for a bolt. What is shown here is a screw. In this case, when you call it as a screw, the size of the screw is normally much smaller, say under 10 mm. That is called as a screw generally. Next is the stud. So you can see here, next type of bolt is called as a stud bolt. So this is a stud bolt. Now what you see here is, this is a bolt which doesn't have head, without head. So this is a body of the bolt of diameter D, and on this body you can see a threading is cut on one side of a length M, threading is cut from the other side also of length N, and the part in between, some length in between, is unthreaded. So there is threading on both sides and there is no head. So how do we use it? That is shown over here. So you can see again part A and part B, they are to be fitted. They are to be clamped with each other. So out of that, to part B, internal threading is done. So you can see here internal threading. So in this internal threading, this lower part of the threading of this bolt, stud bolt, will be fitted here. So this M part of the threading will be engaged over here. Then this part unthreaded will be here, and then you put part number A, which you want to clamp. It will have a hole of diameter D1, which is larger than D, so that you can put this part A over here. And after you put this part A, the threading N, that will project out. And you are supposed to notice one fact, that this threading which is up to here, that line, this line must be below this line. So this is the thickness of the plate A, whereas this is where the threading has started. So threading has started slightly from below the level of A, so that this nut, when you put, now this is a nut, so when you fix this nut, the nut will have sufficient threading so that the clamping will take place. Suppose this line is ending above A, suppose this line ends here, this line, suppose it ends here by mistake, that means this thickness is less than this P thickness, then what will happen, nut will come up to here, it will not come further down, and then there will be space here, and the clamping of A will not take place. So in order that the clamping of A should take place, the threading of this part should be under the level of part A. That means suppose this P is 16, this length is 16, then this has to be more than 16. This should be 16 plus, maybe 1, 2, or 3 mm. So that this 16 mm will be here, and the threading, some threading is still available over here. So that the clamping will take place, the lower surface of the nut, you will be able to touch it to A, and then there will be effective clamping. So that is called as a use of a stud bolt. This is how stud bolt looks, and this is how the stud bolt is assembled, shown in assembled condition. You can again see a stud bolt here. This is the same stud bolt, but in this case, this part, when you see this cross like this, the indication of cross means that this is a flat surface. So this much part is a flat. So you can think of this part, say something like this. And then there is a threading here and another threading over here. So this is another stud bolt. Here it is a square shape, and here the stud bolt has got a collar. So you can see this is something like a washer. It will work like a washer. So when you put it somewhere, this will go and stop here. So suppose there is a part in which you want to fit this, then it will go into the threading, and then this, because of tape, it will not go further down. So some applications you can have for this kind of a stud bolt. Now the next is headless taper bolt. Now this again is a bolt. It has got, as such, it has got no head, but then this part of this bolt is given a taper shape. 1:30, that is the indication of a taper. And you can see here the diameter is, basic diameter is D, threading diameter is D. Then this is 1.2, slightly more than D. And after, now see this corner to this corner, that means this diameter is 1.2D. And on this side, the diameter will be decided by the slope. Now when the taper is 1:30, what it means is, suppose you draw a triangle, that means this line is this line, then for 30 units of length like this, this will be 1 unit. So 30:1, that is a proportion which indicates this slope. So the taper shape, now this is a taper shape. What I have shown is not 1:30, because 1:30 is very, very small angle over here, which is shown over here. So whatever slight taper you see here, that is forming a similar triangle where this length along the axis is 30, and the length perpendicular to the axis is going to be 1. So that is the meaning of taper 1:30. Now where this bolt is used is, again in some cases you are not having any facility for holding this head. So this taper head fits into the plate which has got a taper hole, and as a result of wedge action, this taper